So introduce yourself. And I think he might be one of the babies of the network too. But I know he's one of the babies on this platform tonight. Introduce yourself, Mr. Ricardo.
Hello, everybody. First, I just wanted to thank, you know, Miss Angela, you know, for having me. I'm really grateful for this opportunity. Yes, I'm also a part of the network. This is my going into my third year. I guess my trade by day is I'm a teacher. I'm a filmmaker. I have a series on YouTube. It's called Hurt People, Bitter and Broken. I have a movie coming out July 10th. It'll debut on YouTube. I'm really excited about that. And then I'm working on my book. It's coming out the top of the year. It's called Trauma, Healed People. So I'm just excited about all God is doing in my life and all of you guys' life as well.
Amen, amen. And y'all, we got somebody that stopped by real quick. They don't have a long time because unfortunately they are incarcerated, and they want to share just a little bit. If y'all would allow them to share, if you would introduce yourself, please.
My name is Mr. Cornell Drummer, and I'm an incarcerated individual for 30 plus years. And thank you for having me, ma'am. You know, and I'm here in the state of Texas, and, you know, I share, you know, criminal justice reform and, you know, try to teach brothers how to fight and, you know, come to unity with themselves and try to, you know what I'm saying, reform our criminal justice system and to bring awareness to the struggles that we go through.
Wow. So how did you end up there?
Well, I was charged with a murder case and a drug case that I did not commit. And based upon the corruption in our counties and our towns and our states and our cities, you know, I was a victim of this. And because of that, you know, I was convicted by two separate all-white jury trials with a former assistant district attorney as my attorney and with closed doors and police officers standing behind me. And with that being said, you know, there's no way I could win, you know, in a situation like that. So, you know, that, you know, gave me a sentence of 154 years. Something I didn't commit.
Wow. So what are you what is your message to the people today?
My message to the people is to, you know, find some type of common ground to come together in a unity to have our voices heard, to be able to stand up and speak out about issues like this that's affecting our criminal justice system and destroying our men and our women, you know what I'm saying, of society, you know what I'm saying, and sending people to death for, you know, in prisons for crimes they didn't commit, because that's a very sad thing for a person to be in prison for something they didn't do. So, you know, it's very sad that people's families are being destroyed behind these operations that we need to, you know.
So if anyone wants to find out information about you or support you on this journey, how can they do that?
Well, they can go to change.org, ma'am, and go, you know, sign on them, you know, to try to get some, you know, bring some unity and some voices for us, you know what I'm saying, to our state representatives and our senators alike, you know, to try to address these issues, because they are very powerful issues that need to be addressed, ma'am.
Well, I thank you for stopping by and sharing with us. Again, I wish you much success on this journey. Of course, you are in my prayers. Day one that you've been praying for. Look forward to brighter days for you in the near future. Just stay strong and know we're caring for you.
Thank you very much, man.
Amen. Next, we have Mr. Chris. Mr. Chris, if you would, please introduce yourself.
Yes, Ms. Angela. My name is Chris Gray, and I'm a father, a writer, speaker, and been in corporate America for 20 years. And now I'm switching my focus. And my newest venture is My Father's House KC. And it is a nonprofit organization to empower fathers to be a part of their kids' lives and fight through any barriers and really step up to be the leaders of the family that God has called them to be. And, you know, that's where my passion is. And I've had a great opportunity and have a loving father in my life. And I want to make sure that every child has that opportunity to have a loving father. And I think a lot of the situations we have going on with society right now could be cured with a strong father leading the family. And as we heard of, the incarceration rate really takes fathers away from that. And there's other things going on in society that takes the father away. And if you want to tear away the family, take away the father and the leader that God placed in their lives, and you can tear away the family. And so that's my mission going forward and living out what God has called me to do.
It just muted me, didn't want me to talk again. But anyway, as y'all know, I am one of the CEOs of the Crew Podcast, and our motto, our mission, our goal is to be the change that we desire to see. We come from different backgrounds, different walks of life. So we just want to be out here impacting lives and being the change that we can see. One of the hot topics that's out right now are males. And I want to hear you guys' perspective on that. And we could get each person to chime in on that and what that means to you, what that looks like to you in your perspective. I want to start with Ricardo.
Okay. Miss Angela, can you ask that? What was the question again?
So what does demasculation means to you? What does that mean to you? When you hear that word, what does that mean to you?
Demasculation.
So if you want me to give a definition, I can give a definition that they gave on social media. On one of the sites that I Googled. So I Googled it, and it says, uh-huh. Demasculization is the process of stripping of strength, mm-hmm. courage, independence, and assertiveness. Perpetuation of negative stereotypes, such as the black men are violent, lazy, unintelligent. Other forms of demasculization. Masculinization can include the criminalization of our black men, lack of access to quality education opportunities. These factors can also lead to the feelings of powerlessness, insecurity in the black men, which fuels the cycle of demasculinization. So that is like a overall what they gave me as that definition. So, but what is your perspective? What does that to you? What does that look like to you?
Well, it seemed like from that definition is almost like the devaluing of the black man. And I think that I wanted to say this to be, you know, because he was talking about fathers. And I just wanted to say shout out to the real fathers, black fathers, all fathers that are in the household being supportive, because I really do think fathers really matter and they're important. And I was blessed to be able to have a strong black father. And I know without the presence of a father, I wouldn't be who I am today. So I love in the sense what he was talking about. And I think it kind of coincides with the de-emasculation of black men or men in general. Like if they can get them out of the household and away from the family, then we're not able to survive or even thrive. And I was just thinking too, just in general, like I would say, even growing up in the inner city, I feel like we're kind of at like a disadvantage, especially with mothers being, you know, single mothers, and then now playing both mother and father, and then these young men, young black men, young boys growing to be young black men, I feel like are yearning for a father, and they just go about ways of just trying to search for that love. And I think as a black man now, I feel like we don't have a voice. And I feel like, because I think being a child, being a little black boy, I think we've been taught to not share with how we feel. And I feel like that it hurts generations of young boys that grows up into men, because when you have a voice and you want something to say, but then you've been taught as a kid, you know, be tough and, you know, don't be a punk. And, you know, you grow up and a lot of young black boys that grow up to be men, the only emotion they know is like anger or aggression, because it's like all of this pent up frustration and wanting to have a voice, you know, and your voice being silenced. So I think we don't even know as a culture, I guess generation from generation, we give these things to our children, you know, and we don't even know it affects us. And so I feel like that's a part of even being this, I don't even know how to say the word accurately, but being this emasculated, our voice, because our voice matters. And when we don't have a voice and we don't have positive representations of who we are in our communities, and we lack the resources, it can be tough. And I want to say this in closing, you know, growing up in inner city for me, when I used to see the, you know, boys that looked like me posted up on the corner, I didn't think much of it because I thought it was my norm. But now that I'm older and I'm evolving and elevating and seeing different things, it really saddens me to see young people, you know, on the corner. It saddens me to keep seeing people that look like me getting killed, because I'm like, in my mind, I'm always like, yo, it's a millionaire in the projects. But because of where they come from, and because, you know, them not having examples, or they feeling like, listen, this is all I know, you know, they're never able to really reach that fullest potential. So,
right. Who wanna chime in next?
Okay. So, to go on with Ricardo, it is, you know, we're about almost five generations in of boys raising boys instead of men raising boys to become men. And when you have that, you have mothers trying to play both roles, but it also goes back to you were talking about affection and being able to talk. I had a friend that I was over their house, and I hadn't seen him for a while. Went up, gave the dad a half hug. Wasn't even a real hug. He's like, nice to see you. And the son started crying. And I didn't think anything. I thought he was joking at first, but then I realized, he's like, you haven't hugged me in 20 years. And this is, you know, about 20 years ago when this happened. And for me, I hug my dad all the time. And with my son, I'm a single father. So I show my son affection, tell him I love him. And it's, as black men, we feel like, oh, we can't tell our sons that we love them or show them affection. And it really perpetuates that generation over generation of just suck up your feelings, don't show your feelings yet. Our main role model for what a man should be is Jesus. And Jesus loved his friends. He cried when Nazareth died. And so if we follow his lead and follow his model, there's a lot of things that we show emotion, we're strong, we lead people, and we care for people. And so as we use Jesus as our leader, then that's the role model that we should be following, and that way we can make sure everyone feels that they're loved. And I think that's what we're missing in the brown and black communities, is that love that we feel from our fathers.
So who went next? Pony, you want to try it?
Yes, indeed. Honors to the men of God that spoke before me. Can you hear me loud and clear?
Yes, we can.
Okay. All right. And I'm going to piggyback after what the last man of God said, not to take anything away from the young man of God, Ricardo. You know, when I think about the Lord and Savior Jesus, right? Talking about de-emasculation. And I'm going to try to be as clean as I possibly can. But according to good old Webster, it says that when you take the testicular fortitude, like the honorable Farrakhan like to say, testicular fortitude, right? They know the potency and the power that we have as men. Which explains why when you look at the AIDS that they've been using to try to destroy us as a people, because they know the type of love that we have for ourselves and each other. Which goes into why they changed the music and why a lot of what they're calling music now, the most popular music, is so-called crap music. And I put a C in front of what it used to be, rap music, right? Where they're paying millions of dollars to these artists, these phenomenal artists that can sit back. Some of them are so divinely gifted that they can just don't even use a pen or a paper and can speak all kind of things, right? But one of the things that they're doing, and these major white power structures, I'm gonna call it the way that it is, right? They will pay these guys millions and millions of dollars for them to be able to rap about how many ends they can kill, this and that, right? That's another part of the plan. Now, let me go back to the Lord and Savior Jesus, right? They took the most prominent figure within our scriptures and even de-emasculated him, because they changed his image according to what Revelation says. You can't burn anything white. I don't care how much you try. And that's heartbreaking. And they know that most of our people is going to be so lazy, they're not going to really do a self-study of the scriptures. That's why they use Hollywood and Michelangelo, their artists, painting everything of good substance. They want to make it European, any image after European. In the sense of the Heavenly Father, that's even above Jesus, right? This is real, because now we have to hit them hard, y'all. This is, if you get to know me, it's about taking your soul back. And when you take your soul back, you start to reject everything that the white power structure gave us that wasn't for our benefit, it was for theirs, right? And this is why they don't want us, like even what we're doing now, even on a forum like we're doing right now, because that's unity. Because they know there's not a man on this earth that compares to us. They know that. We was the first children of the Most High according to all scriptures, right? We was the first children of the Most High according to biology, archaeology, anything that you can name. We were the first ones here. And what they did is they did a great job of removing our image and replacing it with theirs, de-emasculation. And one of the things that great America, Hollywood, love to do is they're no longer taking the testicles. They want to put our men in a dress. The same way they're doing with Tyler Perry. They love to see us in a dress because they know a pale man or any other man can't even begin to compare. Right? You name another man that has experienced castration, had to deal with watching his mother, his sister, and his daughters get raped by the same evil beast, right? Who's in the image of a Caucasian, right? And then sit back and make us look towards a Charles Manson looking Jesus. You see what the trick is? You got to reject that, y'all. You got to reject that if you want your soul back.
Mr. Troy, you got to introduce yourself and chime on in. Welcome, 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 welcome.
All I can you hear me?
Yes.
All I can say, the devil is a lie. He tried to stop me from getting up here, but me and my wife worked until we got up here. My name is Troy Reed, just a simple man. I'm a deacon in my church. And I can just say, if you follow God, like I said, I'm just a simple man. I don't have titles behind my name. I don't have degrees behind my name. But if you be obedient to God, He'll put you in positions and places like I am now with these fine young gentlemen that's on this podcast here, you know, and letting my voice be heard about what's happening in the community and to our Black young males. And I have to be the example to these Black young males, not only them, but I have to be the example to drug users because I'm a ex-addict. So I have to be an example to them and let my voice be heard. I don't have to preach scriptures because that Christ in me, all I have to do is show up and let them see the difference that God made in my life. I don't have to quote scripture, the Bible, verse by verse. All I have to do is show up and let my light, let Christ shine through me and let God give me the opportunity when they speak, then God opens the door for me to come in and talk about Him. You know, and I'm trying to catch up real quickly as I can of what I heard the topics was. And I want to get on the topics of our young Black males. What we done in our community, we drew a line in the sand. We tried to go on the streets and get the guys on the streets to change their ways and to get off the streets. But the longer we were doing that, the young coming up behind them was hitting the streets. So we had to draw that line in the sand. And let's get these babies before they get on the streets. Let's start pouring into them. Let's start seeing where their heads at. Because these kids have a lot of trauma. The young man said he's doing the father thing. That is definitely needed in Black communities from where the Black fathers are absent in their lives. Because the truth of the matter is that father is absent, but the mother is still bringing somebody in that's not showing or being a good role model to that child. So we have to step in and help the school board out, help the teachers out, help the parents out, giving them an avenue. I mean, it's all choice. Now, do you either take it or not? If you don't take it, well, okay, this is where you'll be at. But if you do take it, this is the avenue we can help you. And the young man was talking about, they were talking about Christ. Well, when you talk about Christ, you got to talk about the body of Christ. And you got to understand, everybody's not going to be the head. Somebody got to be the hands. Somebody got to be the feet. Somebody got to be the mouth. Somebody got to be the nose. Somebody got to be the ears. Everybody can't be the same part of Christ. So if any of them young men has something that I can come to it and I don't understand what they're doing, I can take the trash out for you. I can take that off of you. I can put some chairs up for you. Just as long as you focus on what God has you to focus on, let me come in and help you get whatever you need done. Just because I don't understand it doesn't mean I can't be a part of it. And that's a problem that we have in the Black communities now. If it's not their ideal, then they don't want to be a part of it. If they didn't come up with the idea of doing something positive, they don't want to be a part of it. Just because we don't understand it doesn't mean God didn't give them the vision. If God gave any one of these men a vision and they called Troy Reed and said, Troy Reed, man, I need some help. What do you need help with? I don't need to understand your vision. God didn't give it to me. He gave it to you. So where can I help? How can I put my hands to the plow? You know, people look at me and say, Troy Reed, voting? Yeah, I'm voting. I'm not worrying about the president and all that. I'm worrying about my local community voting. Because that's who makes the difference in my community. The mayor, the city council, and all of those people, the judges, the superior court judges in Elizabeth City, those people get voted in. So if we don't like it, I got to come and help people put out votes, cast out votes, help people to learn the knowledge of voting. Like I said, I'm just a simple man, but I have a voice that can be heard in the community. I have a voice that can help either one of these young men and what they're doing in some kind of way. just because I don't agree with, I threw that agreeing stuff out the window a long time ago. Because if you're a man of God and God gave you a vision, then I'll be there to help you in any way I can to push that vision forward. Thank you for your time.
That's it. And we call that having each other's back. I call it I am my brother's keeper, because that's what I do. You know, I believe in supporting everybody. I don't have no picks. People be like, why you don't ever be pushing your books? Why you don't push your book? You're an author. That's not what I'm here for. I'm here to push other people. Because there's some scripture over there. Like, I ain't no theologian. I don't know the Bible like that. I don't walk in no office. I just know from the things that I've been through. But I know it's a scripture in the Bible that said, if you be willing, he, and you open your mouth, he'll give you them things to say. Because he done did it for me before. I done watched the live. I done came up off that live, and I look back at that live, and I'm like, who that was? But he'll give you what you need to say when you need to say it. But you have to be willing. That's why when he dropped those three words in my spirit 3 years ago, it's something about them threes, y'all. Something about them threes. Y'all gonna catch it. But it's something about them threes. He dropped it in my spirit 3 years ago. Love. Well, it was learn, love, lead. And he gave me, it was three of us. And he gave us 121 days of prayer, because he gave me Psalms 121. Us to stand on Psalms 121. Look to the hills. But see what people do. They take these scriptures and they look at them and they take them literally like something finna come up out the sky and save you. No, baby. You look up there. It's just to remind you, because when you look out, you can see all his wonders. And it just reminds you that you can, but you got to get up and do something. It ain't gonna happen by itself. That's why I constantly say we are the change that we desire to see, because guess what? We got to be that change. It ain't gonna change if we don't change it. So what are some things that you guys are doing? Because I want people to be able to really connect with you guys and be able to follow you, support your programs, support your brands, you know, whatever you're doing. I want to know, what are you doing to impact this world? What do you want your legacy to be? What do you want people to remember you by? How are you being that change right now? Mr. Chris?
So my nonprofit is how I'm being the change that I want to see. And I was always taught, if you identify a problem, come with a solution. And this is something that God put on my heart about a year ago. And I don't know if anybody else on the panel that when God tells you something, sometimes you argue with him. He knows best, but we still got to argue. And so he knows my heart. And I was told, if you know something from God when it's too big for you. And this was one of those that he gave me the vision, told me everything, how to make it work, and starting out with just a house. And it's going to be a house where fathers can come. One of the things that, even if you get visitation as a father, then they're like, there's certain stipulations that you have to meet in order to even have your kids, even after you've been given visitation. There's a stand up where Chris Rock was talking about that the judge wanted to see the house and the beds and the refrigerator and stuff to see what he had there. This is Chris Rock. He's a millionaire. And the judge wanted to see if he had beds for his kids when they came to visit him. Imagine just a normal guy. And so the house is going to provide a house where for free people can come and stay. They can rent it out, not really rent. They're not paying it. But they have their kids every other weekend. They can come and they have a place to bring their kids, where they'll have their own room. And then when we're not using it for that, then we can set it up for visitation. Because when you are just getting visitation with your child, a lot of times you go to the courthouse, they put you in a room with three chairs, one for the observer, one for the child, and one for the father. That is not a productive way to learn and meet your kid, especially if you haven't been a part of their life for 12 years. No, everybody's coming in at a different level. We want to meet people where they are and get them to where they need to be and be a part of their kid's life, because it's such an important role. And for fathers that say, oh, well, my kid's better off without me, statistics would say otherwise. I mean, if a father's not in the house, have an 80% chance of incarceration for the brown and black community. So then that just starts the whole process over again. So if you look at statistics, father is well needed. And if you don't know how to be a father, I want people to come to me. I have a lot of godly men that have been willing to help out and show young men or older men how to be a father. Because even if fatherhood doesn't come with a manual. We got the Bible that gives us a manual on how to live, yet every child's different. And every time you try, it's going to be a little bit different. But we want to encourage you that you can do it. And we want to be that change. And you know, one of the other things I'm working on are some fatherhood books and the wisdom that we can pass from one generation to the other. And then, you know, living how Jesus, leadership principles of Jesus, where I was thinking it was going to be a corporate leadership book. And then after talking to a couple of people, and what God showed me is that it's really a fatherhood book. And that's really what he's sending me around. I've been a single father for about 14 years now, and it's been the most challenging yet rewarding thing in my life. And I just want to make sure that fathers know that you have the support and you can do it.
Amen.
Can I comment on that?
Yes, you can.
First of all, I want to commend that guy, you know, for his vision and creating a father's, you know, house where fathers will come and, you know, interact with their kids. Because I'm here incarcerated in the prison system, and I'm around a bunch of men who are separated from their families, their kids, most of all. I got a lot of guys in here who cry at night because they don't have access to their families and their kids. And because of that, you know, I've learned that, you know, that's one of the most powerful things that a man can have is access to a family member, mainly his kids. So with that being said, I want to say, you know, I thank him very much for what he's doing, because, you know, that's something that we all need, you know, a place where we can come and have somebody to mentor us on how to become the men we need to be, the fathers we need to be to our kids, because, you know, being separated from your kids is very dramatic. And, you know, like I say, seeing that, you know, that's very powerful what he's doing. I want to say thank him very much.
And you're welcome. And that's one of the things that we looked at. I have an elder at my church who does prison ministry. And that's one of the things that him and I talked about, is that there's a need for people that are coming out of prison. My niece's dad was wrongfully incarcerated for 23 years, and thankfully he was exonerated. And trying to come back into your kid's life after 23 years, especially, it's bad when you did something, yet when you didn't do something and you got wrongfully accused, and trying to build that bridge and get back into life. Good things with little girls, father always has time. With a young man, it's how much work do you want to put in to be a part of his life? Because once a young man thinks he's a man, you're going to have to work harder to get in there. And a lot of times you start out with just a relationship. You don't have that father-son relationship. You can start out with a relationship, and then you can get to a mentoring relationship. And hopefully and prayerfully, you get to the point where they still look at you as a father. So thank you for that. And that is one of the things that we're going to be working on too.
Okay, sir. Well, you know, can I speak on that again? Well, you know, it takes men to make positive decisions and how to become fathers in their kids' life. Because, you know, if people are coming from environments that's toxic and drugs and, you know, selling drugs and gang relations and stuff like that, you can't navigate, you can't balance them out. You have to try to make a positive decision on how to choose one or the other. If you give them a kid over drugs and all this madness, then yes, you will become a better father to your kids. But if you choose in the streets and drugs and all these other negative activities, then you can't be a father to your child. So it takes groups like, you know, men coming together to be able to mentor men and to be men and fathers to their kids, because a lot of kids today are doing drive-by shooting and stuff like that. It's hard trying to convince a kid to put a gun down when they're being influenced by the public. You know, by the environment, you know, that they grew up in. We need men out there like yourself, sir, to be able to mentor us and to becoming fathers to our kids. So thank you again.
Thank you. Anybody else want to chime in?
Yeah, if you don't mind, can you, again, just doing a mic check. Let's talk about WIC for a minute. Remember, we got to attack the evil one and their kind for all of these so-called programs that they design, and this is a key point, but them and their kind in mind and not in ours. And what's the definition of WIC? Women, infant, children, right? And they made it seem like it was such a good thing to accept this program and this programming. And for those of you who don't know or pretend like you don't know, WIC means women, infant, children. Don't say anything about a man, right? And y'all know the story. Let's do some background because I don't want to spend too much time on it, but we got to address certain issues. One of the number one destroyers that had destroyed our people before accepting that. And what's so unique about the evil one of their kind's wicked system is it's okay for them to get, and anyone can fall on hardship. That's not what I'm talking about. But when they create a program where it goes second, third, and fourth generation, where our women and children have to depend on a system to provide food, clothes, water, and shelter, something's wrong with that. Something's wrong with that. And most of the crime that's taking place, and now I'm almost ashamed and shout out to Deacon Troy, man, because we didn't come up like that. Honor to my father who passed away 6 months ago. I can speak on behalf of a real father, Keoff Ray Atun, also known as Mr. Charlie Felton. My father, who took responsibility for me, along with his brothers, my uncles, and my mother's brothers, and my grandfathers on both sides, and my godfather. Shout out to him as well, who also made a transition, Illubany. Real fathers, real men, who prided ourselves on being able to take responsibility, right? We have to get back to that as brothers.
Can I just piggyback, Brother Hanung Bakatun? Just to give y'all understanding what he's talking about, because I did a lot of mentoring and I coached youth. I did a lot of youth football. Now the WIC that he's talking about is what he mean by generational is the woman don't have to do anything to try to get off. All she has to do is keep having children to stay on. Now these children's fathers are being taken away. So now you have other men coming in, like I said earlier, coming in and not guiding the young kids in the proper way. They're using them as a tool to sell drugs. They're using them as a tool to commit crimes for them because they know the child's age. Because there's no stipulation on the WIC program. Now, if they want the WIC program to be successful, then you'll tell this young lady, then we'll give you 2 years on this program. We'll help you get an education. And after your education, we'll help you get a job. And then we'll help you get a house to get on your feet, basically. But as long as there's no stipulations on this program, then the cycle, like he said, is going to be generational. I seen my mother do it, so now I'm going to do it. That's basically what he's alluding to about this WIC program, is not having no stipulations of help. You get, the more kids you have, the more food stamps you have, the less rent you have to pay. So now you got the boyfriend coming in. He don't have to look for a job because everything's being paid. Now the kids are looking at the two parents saying, if I get on this system, I don't have to work either. So that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to give people a sense of pride about themselves, women and men. And then the ones that don't want to help the children, then we got programs. We got a Bump Foundation. We got Next Generation Athlete Program that deals with education and athletes. We got AYG as a program that deal with youth. And these are organizations that deal with youth that parents really not helping them or don't care about. I don't see kids 11, 12, I mean, not well, earlier than that. 8 and 9 years old, 4 or 5 of them going to a store, and when they come out, they got a pocket full of stuff. Why? Because this is something I seen with my own eyes. When mama wake up from coming out in the club the night before, and they come up, mama, I'm hungry, get out. They got to get out the house. Mama told the food stamps to get her hair and nails done. Go to the club on Friday. This is, I'm not telling you no statistics. I'm telling you stuff I've seen actually with my own eyes through the programs that I had through the years. How parents, why young parents treat their kids, how kids got to raise themselves. And that's got to stop. So that's why we drew a line in the sand and went to the elementary schools and the junior high schools. To help these young men, the young boys become men and get a sense of pride about themselves. That you don't have to be in the same state that your mother and your father. You don't have to take that line to prison. You can do, it's other avenues you can take. And we have to let them know that we understand a lot more than what they think we understand. Because kids think, oh, we're just adults. We don't understand. Me and Hanun Bakatun, we was in the streets. We saw the coming up of so many kids. We lived it with them. Hey, yo, you come over to my house, man, you know you get something. Because it was that village. And we need to get back to being a village. We need to get back again, people, a sense of pride about themselves. And I'll just, Brother Hanun, I just want people to understand that I know what you mean about the WIC system. And that's basically how it flows.
And that was just one of many other systems that they put in place to get out of the house. We're going to take a commercial break and we'll be right back, y'all. Welcome back. Welcome back. You are tuned in to Men's Panel. Of course, I am the queen of collaborations. You are tuned in to the crew podcast. I am Angela. And I tell you, I have truly been enjoying this conversation with these amazing men. We have some amazing kings that are truly walking in their purpose. They are truly being the change that they desire to see in this world. They are leading and learning love. I tell you, you got to show some love. And love is an action word. It's something that you got to show. We can say we love you all day, but you got to show me you love me. And say, show me the money. Show me you love me, baby. Show me you love me. How you show me you love me? Y'all show me you love me tonight by showing up and being the kings that you are. So hats off to you guys. Hats off to you. I don't got a hat, so I take my glasses off like Patrice say. Glasses off, guys, tonight. Thank you guys for showing up, being the change that you desire to see in this world. I tell you, it's nothing like change. And I just love being in the midst of some powerful men. And I just want y'all to tell. I want to go around. I want people to be able to connect with y'all. So I want y'all to tell them your platforms and how they can connect with what got going on. Because Ricardo said, y'all, he's the filmster. He got films going on. He got some stuff going on that we can support, that we can share, that we can check out. So definitely want to be able to connect with that. And then you got Mr. Chris over there. He got that house that's opening up that's going to be helping some amazing people. He's going to be dropping some books. We definitely want to be able to stay connected to him. And Mr. Troy, y'all, Mr. Troy, see, Mr. Troy didn't tell y'all this, but Mr. Troy them, Mr. Troy told me how they really turned Elizabeth City around and how they got those people in the community up and being about their community. You know, it's one thing to say that we are the village, but when you truly are the village, and you can walk around your community and people know who you are and they see you coming and they know you mean business. That's the kind of stuff they did up there in Elizabeth City. They took their community back. So we definitely want to be able to keep in contact with them so we can see how we can take, because I might need you to go down here to Texas with me, because we need to take Texas back, because Texas is out of control. We need to take Texas back. We need to take it back because they under their own law. We need to take them back and bring them back to being up under the U.S. because they up under their own little stuff. They make their own little rules so they can be over there and be corrupt and do all their little stuff. So I might need you to go down to Texas with me. So we definitely got to stay. We definitely got to stay in connection. Y'all, we're going to go around the circle and everybody going to give their contact information. And I want you guys to make sure that you connect with them. Tell them what social media sites you on, how we can follow. We're going to start with the baby up there. Hold on. You mean? You mute your, you, okay.
All right, can you guys hear me? I just wanted to kind of like, everybody already said something or whatever. I just wanted to add a little bit or whatever because everybody answered it. I think that sometimes you need permission to be who God is calling you to be. And I think that even having something like this, as far as a men, I kind of look at it like in a sense like a men's group. And I think sometimes other men, young men, older men, you know, where we could like, because we could all learn from each other, you know, no matter how old or young you are, everybody is different in experience and wisdom. So I think that it'll be great, I think, to have like from state to state, you know, things like Mr. Chris is doing, like where they have houses for fathers. And also men's group, you get what I mean? Where men can come and they could cry, they could lay their burdens down. Just a plethora of different men, because it's not one type besides God and Jesus Christ. There's not like one man on earth where it's just like everybody's going to be able to relate to. But just having different walks of life where people can pull from. And like I was talking about permission, sometimes you need permission from people to give you hope and to tell you that there's nothing that you can't do. You get what I mean? Because sometimes in life you need literally people to hold you by the hand, tell you like you can do through the ropes. Not everybody is strong-minded, not everybody, because we all could go through something similar, right? For somebody that could take them out, somebody else could have them on drugs, strung out. And for somebody else, they could be like, you know what? This is the fuel that I need to help me get to where I'm going. So I think permission is a must and it's needed to let people know, like, listen, you could do it no matter where you come from, no matter who your mother and father is. I believe God is so good because sometimes God will bless you with surrogate fathers. Sometimes God will bless you with godfathers. Sometimes God will bless you with gym teachers. Sometimes God would bless you in different ways if we're able to really receive where love is coming from. Because I think a lot of times when we want love, right, like if you was deprived of father or mother, you want that love, you grow up and you want that love from your father or your mother. But again, God is so good that God will bless you with so many amazing people in your life or whatever to love you if you're able to recognize where the love is coming from. Me, I grew up and I struggled as a young man. I had a father, but I didn't. My mother wasn't always present. So growing up for me, I yearned to have that affection from my mother. And I didn't have the vocabulary. And that's the thing too, as young men, we don't have the vocabulary to say a lot of times how we feel. We just know how to just act up and act out and, you know, and just be angry. You get what I mean? And we don't know how to say, you hurt me. And I think that generation to generation, a lot of us, our parents and their parents, it's like, and it's kind of like invisible wounds. So if your mother, your father didn't have the mother or father that they need, they pass down like hurt, you know, generational curses. And that's why I think everybody that's on this live are generational curse breakers. To realize that's what I had or didn't have, that I can choose, you know, the life that I want for me. So shout out to everybody here. And but again, I think permission is definitely needed in counseling, and like I said, talking those things out and realizing that healing is a journey. It's not like a one size fit all. That you kind of constantly do the work. You get what I mean? And I know even for me, like I started my series Hurt People, Bitter and Broken. I went to school for extra science, and my best friend had passed away, and I'm really big on forgiveness. So the last week, I didn't realize that I was spending the last week of his life with him, and we had got into a disagreement, and I remember we had a conversation, and I remember feeling like, yo, I gotta change, because I felt like I was operating and being somebody that I wasn't. And I think that's so important for men to be who they are. You know, when I was younger, I had so much pressure. I feel like I've always been a misfit. I've never fit in. And I'm so grateful to God, because now that I'm older, I realize that I was never meant to fit in. I was always meant to stand out. And I feel like God really started blessing me when I wasn't who I pretend to be. You get what I mean? Like, I had to be who God was calling me to be. I can't be TD Jakes. I can't be all these other people. I can do be Richard at the end of the day. So I think that God could really truly bless us when we stand on what he's calling us to do. And like the other brother said about knowing our roles and who we are, and that, guess what? I need the garbage man. You get what I'm saying? Yo, I need you to flip the burgers at McDonald's. I don't personally eat McDonald's, but you know, but everybody role is important. And I think a lot of times people feel devalued because of social status and all these different things. But I feel like, listen, you at McDonald's, flip them burgers to the glory of God. You get what I mean? Everything matters, and we all are connected. We all need each other. But forgiveness is important. I decided in my life I wanted to make a change, but it took me a long time to get to where I needed to be in God. But I realized forgiveness is always something that I tell people, because, you know, a couple of days later, my best friend had, you know, went to sleep and he never woke up. So it bothered me for years. Like, you know, he reached out to me and I didn't answer. And I was down for a long time. And I started writing my experiences, and then I started having doubt and I can't do it. And this one guy, and this is what I'm talking about, permission. I was reaching out. God is so good. I wanted to be an actor always. I never had the resources. I never knew where to go. I didn't know anybody in my community where I'm from. I have a population is like 90,000 people and where I'm from. And I reached out to this guy or whatever. And I seen a series on YouTube. I'm like, how do you audition? How do you do this? The guy told me, said, listen, create your own. I felt like in that moment that God was being like a beacon of light, because he didn't know me, I didn't know him. And it was just like he was giving me permission, like, to go be great and go do what it is God was calling to do. And then the moment he was telling me this, I started getting overwhelmed. I can't do this, making all these excuses. Like, God, like Moses, God, pick somebody else. You get what I mean? Like, and I wasn't realizing, because I was sitting in church the other day, where when God equips you, or God gives you a vision, or God gives you a dream, and he tells you to go do it, we don't realize that God is with us. A lot of, like Joseph, he went through all of the stuff he'd been through. And the word says that God was with him in that prison. You get what I'm saying? God was with him in the pit, all the way to the palace. And we think like, okay, God is going to be like, just go and do it by yourself. But we don't realize that God, he's with us. So he's been with me. He's with you guys. Lord, Lord, Lord. Can you guys hear me? I'm sorry. I don't know what happened. Hurt people, bitter and broken. This series, it's on YouTube. The subtitle is Bitter and Broken Web Series. Of course, it's about hurt people, and how, you know, we're hurt. And so I don't know. And it's really about eventually getting to the healing part. But it's just a bunch of people going through hurtful things. I play a young father who's an alcoholic, who's a baby boy, and he doesn't really, all he wanted to do is party, because he doesn't realize that he has trauma. He doesn't want to deal with the trauma. So what he does, he turns up and drink. And then the other character, Bashir, is a young man. He's a pre-EK kid. He's a people's pleaser. He wants to help everybody else, but doesn't know how to take care of himself. And then Bree, she's a young woman who's been promiscuous, and she's trying to find out where she's from, because she's been in the system. And it's season 2 pick up with 3 little boys, and they're living on the streets. Their mother is addicted to love. I just wanted to change the narrative, because people don't realize that you can get high off of people. You get what I mean? And it's real. Like, people could be a drug. The wrong kind of people could be a drug to you. And people sometimes are set to be distractions. So
how follow you? What social media sites are you on?
Okay, so Facebook, Hurt People, Bitter and Broken, the series. Instagram, Hurt People series. Facebook, Ricardo Richard. And Instagram, Ricardo Richard. And YouTube, Bitter and Broken Web Series.
And the movie drops on?
July the 10th.
July the 10th. We're going to be sharing the link on the page. So y'all make sure that y'all check out the page later on. I'll be sharing the link. Okay, Mr. Trey, how can we follow and support you and connect with you?
Well, you can follow me on Facebook. On the tour arena, or you go, if you want to get on the things that we're doing, you can follow my church page, which is the Victory Praise and Worship Center, Pastor Daniel Spence, First Lady Michelle Spence. You'll see all the community events that we'll be doing, all the involvement that our church will be doing in the communities. Our church is basically an open book. So all our events and everything we'll be doing will be on the page, Victory Praise and Worship. And anything you see that they're doing, you know I'm a part of. So like I say, you can contact me on just Facebook, Troy Reed. And could I just say one thing to Chris? I don't know if he's doing it already, but one of the changes that we made in Elizabeth City, we made our face and name to our vote. And what I mean by that, if you want my vote, then you need to know me. See, you have a program going on. So every official in that community should know your face. If you want to do an open house and you voted for them, they need to be at your open house. You need to be able to walk, you need to be able to be in the grocery store and see the mayor. He come up and you say, "Hey Chris, how you doing?" They want your vote. But they don't know our name because we don't put our face and our name to the vote who we're voting for. So what we did in our community, you come to our church and you solicitate our votes. Then guess what? When our church have a community event, we expect you to be there. We expect you to be walking around meeting people at our church event. Because granted, you came to our church and asked for us for our support and votes. The chief of police the same way. And the police that's on that force should stop by and say, "Hey, Chris, how you doing? Just stop by checking on you, man." We have to have a relationship. That's the key thing, relationship to everyone in the community, especially our leaders, from the mayors to the police. Because I don't know if y'all noticed or not, when we're talking about systems changing, police cars used to have protect and serve on the side of police car.
Right.
If you look at most of the police cars now, you know what it says on the side? Law enforcement.
That's it.
Right. So they're not coming to serve. They're coming to enforce the law.
That's it.
That's why so many things is happening, because we're not paying attention to how they changed just that simple phrase on the police car. So I'm telling you, brother, is yeah, make your name known to everybody that's on your city council, your mayor, because if they want your vote and support, because you have a voice that can reach many people in your community. Now, we can't vote for him, but hey, man, he tried not to let me get the house. Oh, yeah, we can support those, because they help me every step of the way to get my house. When I have something going on, they're there. And the city have funds for people like you. Every city get a budget. Yep. If you don't give a $500, go towards your house, make sure you get that $500. Yep. That's how you make a difference in your community. Is you got to be have a personal relationship with the leaders of your community, because that's what we're doing.
Yeah, they got to know who you is. That's why I keep telling
you. They got to know who you are. Just don't say I'm building that. I got a house on here for this. No, I need you to be a part of this.
They need to know who you are. That's a visibility.
Exactly.
I like people that.
They got to know who I am. They gonna know me before they see me. They gonna hear me coming.
Yeah, and that's gonna make a change. Now they got to see your community different.
And Mr. Troy, one of the things I want to point out that you just said is that we went from community policing to policing the community. And that flip changed everything. And so when you have police officers that are policing the community, they're not community policing. They're not building those relationships. It used to be they would know who all was in the town or who all was on the block. And they go say, hey, what happened? But now they want to just enforce the law. But if you go back to community policing and you build relationships with the people in the community, now you're a part of the community. You're not enforcing something in the community. So.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Because just you getting to know the police, the police on the police force, when you have something, now they get to know who's connected to you. Yeah. Then when they get to know who's connected to you, they get to know who's connected to them. You see what I'm saying? See where I'm going with it? Yeah. So if you start that personal relationship, then they got to start a personal relationship with everybody that's connected to you and connected to them. And now they have no choice. They have no choice but to say, okay, they might not know him, but I better ask questions of who he know. Mm-hmm. Do you know Chris? Yeah, I know Chris. I ran to the house and help out around the house. Okay, now that might change the whole situation. Just because they said, I know Chris.
Yeah.
Because you have that relationship with the police force. You know what I mean?
Yep.
So I just want to throw that point out to you, brother. And I know I'm in North Carolina. I don't know where you at. But, hey, if I can just do anything for you, man, just let me know. Like I said, if you follow me on Facebook, Troy Reed, or Victory Praise and Worship Center.
And like I said, it's no matter what. And the great thing about my father's house, it could be my father's house, Dallas, my father's house, New York, my father's house, L.A. Once you got the blueprint, it's cookie cutter. You just pick it up, put it in a different city. Every city needs this. And so it's about fulfilling a need that's everywhere. And we need it everywhere.
Amen. Amen. So how can we get in touch with you, Chris?
So, and my email address is chris@myfathershousekc.org, or my website will be launching on Father's Day next week, and it'll be myfathershousekc.org. No apostrophe S. Web doesn't like apostrophe S's, so no apostrophe S. So myfathershousekc.org.
All right. Man, Haru, how can we get in touch with you?
First of all, honors to all the brothers up here on this panel tonight and all the brothers that's listening. It's live as well as when it's going to be archived, okay? I have my own business. As you can see, Sound Therapy with Magic Man Haru LLC. Trying to cross my T's and dot my I's as far as business, right? But in about 2 days, I'm getting a career of 38 years operating Nighthawks in Operation Takeover. I was taken over almost 38 years ago on a Thursday, 12:30 midnight. And I started from walking the streets of Nam to going to different synagogues, churches, mosques, because religion was is one of the tools that was used to not only destroy us, but to keep the separation going. Okay? But the unique thing about that wake-up call is I received a message. And it says, wake up, Adam asleep, and take this message to the people who need it the most. And that message was Battersheep, otherwise it's Genesis, chapter 15, verse 13 and 14. Take time to look it up, y'all. And I challenge all of the so-called leaders, especially in the Black church, Black synagogue, and so-called Black masjid. Because we, as children of Abraham, according to our scriptures, be it the Torah, right? Be it the New Testament or El Quran, right? It's take time to look that, because when you talk about changing our positions, thanks to Joe Biden, thanks to real leaders who know, thanks to people that as of soon to be June 19th, the so-called Juneteenth that's coming up, it's a confirmation of what our scriptures has already said. And it can't deny it. Hollywood don't hide it. Our scriptures said it first. The so-called leaders, either they don't know it or they don't want to reveal it. But I only hold the so-called leaders to a small or minute responsibility when it comes to freeing our minds and our bodies, right? But that was the message almost 38 years ago, coming up in 2 days. You can find me broadcasting. Remember, podcasting is mine. But you can find me broadcasting with the greatest company of internet radio, especially during the digital age. I'm the host of We Will Aware You. Matter of fact, let me do this plug right quick. My next advancement, because no more time for lessons, because lessons will step backwards. Right? I'll be speaking about we have a shut down. And, you know, I was given the military mindset, but a lot of people's not ready for that there. But you can start off not just boycotting, but stop supporting the people who don't care about us. Okay? You can find me the way that it is, Sound Therapy with Magic Man, Haru LLC, at gmail.com or magicmanharu at gmail.com. You can email me directly, right? There's many ways you can contact me. If you are serious, then inbox me and I will reveal my business number, separating my personal from my business. And this is about our turn in time, y'all. This is real. If you are concerned about the things that's been happening in our world, right, we have to do this. We have to even go back a time before integration, when we as men and women had no choice but to depend on ourselves and each other. Let's be real. Anything that they created didn't have us in our, you know, in our best interest. It was in the interest of theirs.
Correct.
Okay. We have to do this because, again, according to our scriptures, we are about to inherit and be rewarded for all the hell we've been through for over 400 years. And they not, you know, they not stopping the process. We are, because most people either they don't know or they don't believe it. They was never taught it. Right? So you got to get out of that Hollywood concept that the children of the scriptures look like people other than us. They can't hide it, y'all. They can't hide it. And that's what sound therapy is about, because when you take that time, and the key word is take, for the so-called revolutionaries out there, past, present, or future, what made me different is when they woke me up. It ain't about no gimme. You ain't gonna give me nothing. I'm taking mine from my soul to my mind to my actions and everything, right? We have to do this because they're not going to do it for us. Look at the people, and I ain't talking about the people that's standing, right? Look at the people that's migrating here from other parts of the world. They're not going through no WIC system. They're doing and receiving more in less than one generation than we did in four, y'all. They're not even marching, singing, and dancing and going through the hell. They're not even being shot out in the street like an animal by the so-called, you know, bad police, which is another game, right? Bottom line is we have to do this. And our elders or ancestors or angels, whatever you want to call them, have been waiting on us to do it. If you think I'm lying, you better, you know, again, look up in the book of Psalms, right? Chapter 86 and read the entire chapter. It gives us the responsibility as children of God to, you know, wake up and look out for the children that's fatherless. Shout out to all real fathers out there, y'all. And you don't have to be a father by blood. You can be a father by adoption or adoption. The last thing I want to share is I came up during an era, during the 60s to 70s era, where we had something unique. First of all, ain't no other man on this planet that can compare to us when it comes to mentally as well as spiritually, and everybody don't have that soul. I keep reiterating, right? Soul is when we take responsibility and we have care and concern for ourselves and each other. Other people don't have it. And I also want to say something too before this ends, because I want this put on record. I am not concerned with you and your kind the way that I'm concerned with me and mine. Until other people and to me, you know, I think differently, right? I don't care what other people think. It's about us. Because nobody else cares about us the way that we should do. We have to do this. Starting from forums like this here. We can no longer allow the evil one of their kind to keep killing our men, women, and children and getting away with it. Hold them accountable. And also, I'm going to say something like this. I wasn't going to hold it, but I'm a military mindset. It's my next show that's coming up on June 29th. And right now, we don't have, as a body of people, we don't have the training and the know-how the way other people do that's got an appetite to kill, with or without a reason. So when I say military mindset, I'm not talking about grabbing no gun. Come on, man. You're not ready for that yet. You ain't ready for that yet. But what I do encourage is to take your mind back. That you can do. And we talking about this Asian guy who shot one of our children who no longer have a future, no longer on this planet. We can't allow them to get away with that, yeah?
On this first time.
You can't allow them to get away with that, yeah? You understand? Stop supporting them with your money. Because we are in a serious battle for our lives, y'all. For those of you who are serious, hold them responsible. And again, we can wait for them to do it, but why should we? We have to do this. We had a soul shake. Two brothers would meet each other. Thank the creator for rain, right? Would meet each other. And in the process of a handshake, a real soul shake. See, that's something that we had. Other people didn't have it because they don't have that creativity, right? And in the process of that handshake, we would know how that brother's doing in exchange. If that brother's needs something, if something's going on with his family, and in the process, before the hands was taken away from the handshake, we would exchange a lot of information. We didn't wait. If we knew that that brother needed some lights or whatever, or some food, or maybe a little bit low on funds, we did it automatically. Back then, we was already prepared, because as soul people, we should be able to feel the pain and the need of ourselves and each other. We shouldn't have to wait for them to come to us, y'all. And that's a thing called man's pride. We as black men, we have that. We have to get back to that. Okay? I just want to take time to do that. Thank you so much, International Internet Radio Hall of Fame. My spiritual daughter, the brilliant and beautiful. Thank you for all that you do. I give thanks to the Heavenly Father for sending you. Right? And allow me to be a part of this podium tonight.
Thank
That's my mother. Okay, I'm your brother.
Amen. Well, I tell you, I truly have been blessed on tonight. I pray that everyone that has tuned in have been blessed by something that has come forth from these amazing kings on tonight. I just want to encourage you guys to stay on this journey, to keep doing what you're doing. Know that you have one sister over here that's always rooting for you. Know that because you are now connected, you've come across the platform, you are connected, we grounded, we rooted, we not going nowhere. Huni, that spiritual connection, I'm talking about from day one, that's my Abba, that I met him, fell in love with him, he connected me with Troy. I tell you, God know what you need in your life when you need it, and he will bring people that just connect right there. And I tell you, I fell in love with Ricardo soon as he came on the network. I heard his story. I fell in love with that young man. And I follow him. I see him. He doesn't know, but I follow him. I see his lives often. I see his lives. I don't comment a lot, but I see you, baby. And I thank you for all that you do. I appreciate you, and I am cheering for you. And Mr. Chris, I tell you, the first opportunity, the first time I met him, I think we was on the phone for 2 hours. His spirit is amazing. I'm super proud of him. I cannot wait to see all the amazing things he's doing. He has stepped out on faith, and he is moving forward with this ministry. And I just thank God for each and every one of you guys, because you are being that change that you want to see in this world. And it's just about us moving, and it's just about us doing, because we can have faith all day, but if we don't act upon that faith, if we don't step out and do something, because guess what? Ain't nothing coming out the sky. I keep telling people, they waiting for them white horses to ride down out the sky. They not coming. Get up. Get up and do something. When you get up and you be that change, then you'll start seeing the change that you want to see. And that's what I keep telling people. That's my stance. That's my motto. And guess what? I stand on it. I ain't backing down. I ain't moving. I ain't taking it back. You won't change. You got to be that change. And tonight, I thank you guys for being that change. And know that you got a sister over here supporting you guys. I love you. And thank you for stopping by and sharing with us on tonight. I truly, truly enjoyed you guys. There's been some amazing comments in the comment section. They have been saying they truly appreciate your visions. They think that you guys are powerful, and they have truly enjoyed this conversation on tonight. Y'all get a chance. Please go back and share this live.
You have 1 minute left.
I love you guys, and I appreciate you, kings. Know that I got you. Continue to take your throne. I love you guys. Y'all have a great night. I want to thank you guys for tuning in and sharing with us on tonight. Again, I pray that this have been a blessing to somebody, and that you will continue to lead by example. Be that change that you want to see in this world. I love you guys. Have a good night.
Oh, mercy, mercy me. All things ain't what they used to be now. Where did all the blue skies go? Poison is the